Welcome back to our course, Network Theory and Transmission Lines. So we are in the magnetic circuits, and here we are discussing about different electrical equivalents. So we have done with the concepts of self-inductance, mutual inductance, coefficient of coupling, dot convention, and recently we have covered this different electrical equivalents of different magnetically coupled circuits. And here the concept which is remained here in the module is the ideal transformer. So today's discussion is comprises of this the working and the characteristics and the analysis involved with respect to the ideal transformer, right? So now, so let us move on to this ideal. So coming to the ideal transformer, first we will introduce the working principle behind the transformer. We all know that the basic working principle involved in the functionality of the transformer is nothing but the mutual induction, right? So what is the functionality of the transformer? It usually transfers the energy required to the other circuit through mutual induction. So there can be some in the most wide applications of this transformer is used in any kind of power systems. We consider any kind of power systems, we might find the necessity of the transformer. So why and where it is needed and how it is needed. So let us look into the simple single phase power system. So where you can see here the generator. So usually in practically we can have some big generating stations will be there, which are located at around hundreds or more than 100 kilometers are away from the load center, right? So that means from here we are going to transfer the energy, so that the where we are going to transfer energy is nothing but your loads, right? So this is your final the way you want to supply the power. So this is your load, different loads may be there, and here this is your generating station. So these are big generating stations will be there, so which will be usually located at different locations. Usually it will be more than hundreds or thousands kilometers from the load stations, right? So where here from these generator stations only the power is going to get consumed. So but here, so what kind of things you can have is, so to carry to transfer this power which is generated by the generating stations, we are going to use some long transmission lines. We are going to use some long transmission lines. So this is what which is shown in this single phase power system block diagram. So in this you can see here, usually these long transmission lines carry this power which is generated by the generating stations, right, to the loads. So but here, so generating stations usually a rotating machine, generating station generators are usually a rotating machines, and usually the level of the voltage which it generates is limited to several kilowatts only, right? Usually it is limited to only very few kilowatts, right? So that is the typical value you can see here. It is nothing but around 11 kilovolts. It is nothing but around 11 kilovolts, the typical value. So but if you want to transmit the large amount of power, that means it can be of around in the megawatts, thousands of megawatts. So then what we have to do here is we have to require long transmission lines. So the cross-sectional area of the conductor of the lines, this transmission line, the cross-sectional area of this conducting medium on this transmission line could be a very huge, we may require it may be very huge, and the cost involved also is going to be very much, right? So not only this, this transmission is also, the transmission over a medium is also involves different number of resistances, its own resistances. This transmission line, each transmission line is going to have its own resistances, right? So this huge amount of current usually cause some large amount of power loss through the transmission medium, right? So what kind of losses we may have, different kinds of losses will be there. So these losses may usually incur in some heating of the lines, and most of the energy may get lost and most of the energy may get wasted, right? That means the efficiency of the transmission is going to become very poor through this long transmission lines if you use from generator to the loads directly, right? So these problems can be addressed. Like if you want to say, for example, if you want to transmit a power in the case of around 200 kV or 400 kV, right? So the solution to this problem, right, is usually a transformer. The solution to these kind of problems is usually a transformer. A transformer here makes the use of, between the, acts as the interface between the generating stations and also the load stations. So either it can be a step up or it can be a step down, right? So whereas here from the generating stations, usually the power is limited to 11 kVA, right? So, but here, if you want to transmit a power in the range of 200 kV or 400 kV, for example, these are the typical values. So, or even higher if it is may required up to 800 kV. So then what we are going to do is, so then here we are going to use the step up transformer. Step up transformer in the sense it is going to increase the level, right? It is going to raise the level of the 11 kV to 400 kV. 400 kV as shown in this figure, right? So that means it is going to raise the voltage level to the required or to the desired level, right? It is going to raise the voltage level. So that is here the step up transformer is going to use. So again at the load side, if you want to tune the R, if you want to meet the necessary requirements or the desired values, so we can reduce the load conditions over here by using the step down transformer. This is what a simple example, practical example of a single phase power system, right? Practical example where the transformer can be used, right? Either it can be a step up or it can be a step down transformer, right? So now, if you look into the construction of the transformer, you can see here, right? A transformer usually consists of a rectangular magnetic structure, rectangular laminated magnetic structure. That means here this is nothing but the magnetic laminated core, iron core, So where here the two coils, of the transformer is going to wounded. So as shown in this figure, you can see here two different coils have been wounded. So one, the winding, so this is the winding and this is the other winding. So the winding to which the AC voltage source is connected is nothing but your primary winding of the transformer. And the winding through which the load is connected. So this is your load, as indicated here with R, the load. And this, the coil which it is connected to the load. So that coil is nothing but your secondary coil of the transformer, So we will look into this in detail when we go for analysis. So the currents associated with this is clearly indicated here, IP and IS. IP is nothing but the primary coil current and the secondary current, and VP the primary voltage, VS is nothing but the secondary voltage, or we can say as V1, V2, I1, I2. Any case, and also here the turns of the coil. So the primary coil turns is indicated with the NP in this figure, in this cross section figure, right? In NS is indicated the secondary coil number, the turns involved in the secondary coil is indicated with the NS, right? So NP, NS, or we can say N1 and N2 for our convenience, right? So this is with respect to the construction of the transformer. So let us now look into more. We are speaking about the ideal transformer. What could be the ideal transformer, right? So let us look into the characteristics of the ideal transformer. How it is characterized. So the ideal in the sense practically, which it may not be exist practically, right? Ideal in the sense which may not be exist practically. For better understanding of the our analysis of your transformer, let us consider the ideal transformer first, right? So let us characterize the transformer by assuming, right? So these are the characteristics: zero winding resistance. So zero winding resistance in the sense the resistance of the primary as well as the secondary winding of an transformer is zero in the ideal case. This is with respect to the ideal case, but practically it may not be possible, right? So maximum typical efficiency of a transformer is going to be around 99%, right? So practically it may not be possible, but in the ideal case we might consider for analysis. So it is assumed that the resistance of primary as well as the secondary here of the ideal transformer is zero. That means the both the coils is going to be purely inductive in nature. That means the primary, the power dissipation through the primary resistance is zero in the sense the power dissipation through the primary and as well as the secondary is going to be zero, right? And coming to the next one, infinite permeability of the core. The permeability here, that is nothing but the mu, which is usually indicated with mu. The permeability, we should consider or we should assume the core of, that means the magnetic core which is used to wound the primary and the secondary coil, the permeability of the core should be very high, right? If we have the higher permeability, obviously the lesser MMF. MMF is nothing but the magnetomotive force, right? So what is this magnetomotive force required for flux? If higher permeability, lesser the MMF required. What is this MMF? MMF is nothing but the work done to move a unit magnetic pole, right? Unit magnetic pole in and around the magnetic field is nothing but the magnetomotive force, MMF, right? So that means here, if permeability is high, so less magnetizing current is required to magnetize the transformer core, vice versa, right? So this is one of the ideal characteristics of the transformer. So the other one is no leakage flux. So in general, the leakage flux is also the part of the magnetic flux, but in the practical case, it may not be. When we are analyzing it, we may not consider that it is getting linked with the secondary winding, right? We will consider which doesn't get linked with the secondary winding. But in an ideal transformer, it is assumed that the entire amount of flux get linked with the secondary winding. That is no leakage flux. No leakage flux in the sense that means the primary and the secondary, the both the coils are tightly coupled. Tightly coupled. That means here the coefficient of coupling or the coupling factor K is going to be equal to 1. If there is no leakage flux, obviously the coefficient of coupling, that means that there is no difference in the leakage flux. That means if we tightly couple it, both the coils, that means the linkage, the flux, the linkage flux is going to be same as the total flux. Then the coefficient of coupling is going to be equal to 1. That means here in this case no leakage flux in the sense, in this case the K value is going to be equal to 1. Here in this case the K value is going to be equal to 1, right? Remember, the K value is going to be equal to 1. So in this case, no leakage flux, right? And the next one is 100% efficiency. That means the ideal transformer should not have any losses. The losses can be of eddy current losses, right? Different losses, hysteresis losses, different losses may be there. So these losses usually practically will be there, but we will consider in the ideal case, there are no losses. So the output power of an ideal transformer is going to be equal to the input power. If there are no losses, obviously the output power of the ideal transformer is going to be equal to the input power. So that means it should satisfy the law of conservation of energy, right? Law of conservation of energy. So hence we can have 100% efficiency in the ideal case, right? In the ideal case. So let us little bit more with the respect to different mathematical equations. Let us analyze more with respect to the ideal transformer. So for that, let us consider the circuit equivalent of the transformer. So where here a dot convention is used, and this is the primary coil and the secondary coil. The self inductance of the primary coil. The self inductance of the primary coil is mentioned here as L1, and the self inductance of the secondary coil is L2 over here, right? And the voltages across the primary coil is V1 and the secondary coil is V2. The currents is I1 and I2, and the inductance, the coupling coefficient here is K, and the mutual inductance is M, right? When we couple these two, obviously the mutual inductance concept is coming into the picture. So the mutual inductance term is M here we are going to consider. So let us analyze this. So already we have modeled this kind of circuits, many different circuits we have modeled already these things. And so let us consider analyze in the frequency domain, right? In the frequency domain. So in the previous lecture already we have covered the modeling of different dot conventional magnetic circuits, different magnetic coupled circuits using in the frequency domain and as well as in the time domain, right? So here, as both the currents are entering the dot, obviously the mutual inductance term is going to be positive. So in the frequency domain, so the V1 for the left hand side of the loop, the V1 is given here. V1 is equal to J omega L1 I1, right? L1 dI1 by dt, dI1 by dt is nothing but J omega here, J omega I1, right? J omega L1 I1 plus, as here the mutual inductance is going to be there. So plus, why plus here? Because the mutual inductance is positive, plus J omega M I2. Mutual inductance in the sense, the other current comes to the picture. Current of the other coil. So that means plus J omega M I2. So for the right hand side loop, that is with respect to the secondary coil, we can write V2 is equal to J omega L2 I2, because here it is L2, the self inductance of the coil is L2 I2. L2 here and J omega I2 plus, and the mutual inductance when we are considering the voltage 2, that is with respect to the secondary coil, we should consider the other current, that is J omega M I1. So these are the two equations we got. So now by solving these two equations, you might come across for V2 as, by substituting for the value of I1 from the equation 1, we can get V2 is equal to J omega L2 I2 plus MV1 by L1 minus J omega M square I2 by L1. So by solving these two equations and substituting in the equation 2 for I1, we are going to have this equation V2. But we know that M is equal to K root L1 L2. So what is this equation? This is the important relation between the mutual inductance M and the coefficient of coupling, or coupling coefficient, right? K. Right, this is the important relation, where here L1 and L2 are the self inductances. But for ideal transformer, as I said in the characteristics, while discussing about the characteristics, the ideal transformer, there will be no leakage flux. If there is no leakage flux, means the both the coils are tightly coupled. If both the coils are tightly coupled, the coefficient of coupling is going to be equal to 1. If K is equal to 1, then if we substitute K is equal to 1 in this, so we are going to have M is equal to root over L1 and L2. Now substituting this M is equal to root over L1 and L2 in this V2 equation, you might come across V2 is equal to J omega L2. You can look at here, V2 is equal to J omega L2. And so here M is there. This M value is nothing but, this M value is nothing but the root over L1 L2. Right, this is M value is nothing but the root over L1 L2, right, into V1 divided by L1, into V1 divided by L1 minus J omega. So if m is equal to root over L1 L2, what about m square? M square is going to be L1 L2, right? M square is going to be L1 L2. So here m square is there, instead of m square. So instead of m square over here. So this is the m square over here, right? So this m square is replaced with L1 L2. Is L1 L2. This is also linked to this, right? So L1 L2 into I2 divided by L1. So which is equal to root over L2 by L1, because L1 and L1 is going to get cancelled over here. So in this, what you are going to have here, which is equal to root over L2 by L1 into V1. Why V1 here? What is V1? What is V1? So here we are having V1, right? So by simplifying this complete thing, J omega L2 I2 and L1 L2 is getting cancelled over here. This J omega L2 I2 minus J omega L2 I2 is going to be there. And here plus J omega L2 I2 is there. Both is going to get cancelled over here. And finally, you are going to have here root over, by simplifying this, by root over L2 by L1 into V1. L2 by L1 into V1. So which is equal to N into V1. So where N is nothing but, where N is nothing but root over L2 by L1. Where N is here, root over L2 by L1. Is it clear? Right. So now let us further analyze this one with respect to different current and voltage ratio. So let us again consider the same circuit over here. So we know that already derived with respect to the self inductance and the mutual inductances, the magnitudes of the induced voltage in each coil, we can write it like V1 is equal to N1 d phi by dt, because we know that V is equal to N d phi by dt. So V1 is equal to N1 d phi by dt with respect to the first coil, with respect to the first coil, the induced EMF V1 is equal to N1, because the total flux is going to be linked with the number of turns. If you consider the N1 as the number of turns of the first coil, so N1 into d phi by dt, and similarly V2 is equal to N2 into d phi by dt. V2 is equal to N2 d phi by dt. So from this we can write what could be the V2 by V1. So V2 by V1 can be written as, if you cancel N d phi by dt and d phi by dt over here, we can write V2 by V1 as N2 by N1. V2 by V1 as N2 by N1. So which is equal to N. Which is equal to N. Whereas here, if you apply the, as it is an ideal transformer, the energy supplied to the primary must be equal to the energy absorbed by the secondary. So that means there is no losses here. So it should satisfy the law of conservation of energy. So that means we can write V1 I1 is equal to V2 I2. We can write V1 I1. The V1 I1 is nothing but the power or the energy supplied to the primary, which is nothing but V1 into I1. And the energy absorbed by the secondary is nothing but the V2 into I2. So as per the law of conservation of energy, so supplied should be equal to the absorbed. V1 I1 is equal to V2 I2. So from this, we can write I1 by I2 is equal to V2 by V1, which is equal to N. Which is equal to N, right? Which is equal to N. So here N is the factor ratio. N is the ratio over here. So from this, we can write I2 by I1 is equal to N1 by I2 is equal to 1 by N. 1 by N, right? So we can write it here, V2 by V1 is equal to N2 by N1 is equal to, right, N, which is equal to L square, right? Which is nothing but, previously we can check it already. So root over N is equal to root over L2 by L1. N is equal to root over L2 by Y1. So how this can be N and that could be N? So that means here, we know that from the formula n is directly proportional to l is directly proportional to n square over here, where n is nothing but the n2 by n1, right? So from that we got this equation v2 by v1 is equal to n2 by n1, which is equal to n. So for here we have to make an important consideration over here. So if n is greater than 1, so that means the transformer is nothing but a step up transformer. If n is greater than 1, say for example here n is greater than 1. If n is greater than 1, that means so the n2 is greater than n1. If n is greater than 1, n2 is greater than n1. So if n2 is greater than n1, v2 is going to be greater than v1. So that means the voltage is increased from primary to secondary. V2 is more than v1 means the voltage at secondary is increased to the voltage at increased from primary to the secondary. That means, right, the secondary voltage is greater than primary voltage. So that means here it is nothing but a step up transformer. Say for example if n is less than 1, in that case this n1 is greater than n2. If n is less than 1, n1 is less than n1 is greater than n2. So that means v1 will be greater than v2. The primary voltage is going to be greater than the secondary voltage. That means it is nothing but the step down transformer, because the secondary coil is going to connect to the load. So obviously the voltage is going to get reduced to a desired value. So that means it is nothing but the step down transformer. So this is what the simple analysis behind the transformer, right? So with respect to, we can, so from these equations easily we can calculate the impedance, input impedance with respect to Z1 and Z. If you connect a load over here, how to calculate the impedance and all, easily you can calculate. So Z1 is equal to V1 by I1. So we know the values of V1, I1 and everything over here. From that you can easily get the equations, right? You can easily derive the equations using simply applying the Ohm's law over here. Z1 is equal to V1 by I1. Z2 is equal to V2 by I2. From that, you know the values of V1 and I1. So using that, you can get the equation with respect to the turns ratio, that is N2 by N1. So thank you for listening.